BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
The ceremonial unmasking before the program starts. Welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and tonight we'll be talking about trapping things. Now, with me I have Reading Community Players, and they're doing a production of Agatha Christie's The Mousetrap, and we'll be finding out about that in a few moments and all. I just want to say, glad those of you out there have been doing well with being safe and masking when necessary, because we want to see you out at the shows. And it's always nice, you know, those of you who may have missed a relative or a family member or whatever, know the law. So. Please stay safe so you can get out and see the shows. And by the way, most theaters are still asking you to mask during the performance. A few make it optional. And the actors, for the most part, now are not masked. That was crazy to help the hearing of what was going on, because you didn't want to miss those silent moments, those tender or whatever kind of moments, ominous moments that can happen when your voice is real, real low. So anyway, we're going to have a lot of fun with Reading Community Players and finding out all about the Mousetrap. It's Dame. Well, before I go on that, I just want to say this is national. This is a national month honoring women in history and women in general. And there have been a number of women that have graced the stage here for me from way back when and all. And I want to just note a few, like Terry Mastrobuono. She's superb with a Commedia dell'arte. And if you remember that program from way back when, we had a lot of fun. She taught me some of the things about Commedia dell'arte. Some of the real local ones are people like Betty Lou McLean, Lynn Morrow, both from the academic world in this area. I know myself that I've learned a lot from them, and I know a lot of other people have too. They weren't always, they were tough at times, but they pushed you because they knew you could do it, and that's a good thing. Kate Scuffle from Theater Outlet. Marcia D. Salvatore. She was a past director of the Theater Association of Pennsylvania. I don't believe that's in existence anymore, but she was on the program, and she very much showed what organizations can do to help the individual and theater organizations. I had Wilhelmina Cole Halliday. She was one of the founders to the National Museum of Women in the Arts in Washington, D.C., and she was very gracious to come and appear on the program to talk about how women can make a living in the arts. She, along with Joan Myers Brown from Philodanco, who was excellent dance, for those of you who are up on dance organizations. She is, both of them have made many, many fine contributions to the arts. And there's this lady, she wrote a play, a mystery, Dame Agatha Mary Clarissa Christie, The Mousetrap. And that has had a very interesting beginning. And with me tonight, as I said, are some of the cast members from this recent production of The Mousetrap. And I'm going to introduce you to them at this time. First of all, right next to me is Randy Miller. Welcome to Backstage.
Thank you, David. I'm glad to be back.
I'm glad you are, too. Mary Britton, welcome.
Thank you.
Brian Miller.
Hi, David. Thank you.
You're welcome. And Renata Zumberge.
Hi, David.
Welcome back to all of you. These folks have been doing some marvelous work with Reading Community Players throughout the years and other local theater groups. And I'm interested in finding out what they think about this show. First of all, I believe this is opening this Friday, Randy. And if you'll tell us about the run of the show.
Yes, yes, we do open this Friday. We're in our last two nights of rehearsal, tonight and tomorrow night. We are having a talk back tomorrow night with a class from the university. So that'll be an interesting night for the cast and for the students that are coming in. But we open Friday night, run Friday night, Saturday night at 7:30 p.m. and Sunday afternoon at 3 p.m. Okay. And that's at the George Bear Chapel over at the corner of 6th and Cherry Streets. Thank you.
Not very far from our location right now here in downtown Reading. And so if you're familiar with it, it'll be a very easy way, very easy to get there to see the show. And I've seen some of their work there, and it's a very good space
to work. It's a very nice space to work in, yes.
Yeah. Okay. What made you choose, or Reading Community Players choose, The Mousetrap?
It's a play that I had been looking to do for a long time, and my wife had some influence with that. We have seen the play several times, and it's a play I actually did when I was in college. Way back when. We won't count the number of years back. But every time that I've seen it, it's like it was something new. I had seen it for the first time almost. And it's like you get halfway through the second act, and it's like, oh, I remember this play. And if this happens, this is the play I'm thinking about. So it's very unique in that it's Agatha Christie, like you said, has written many plays. She's most famously known for her books about Perrault and Miss Marple. But again, her plays were famous, and The Mousetrap is probably her most famous play. And so I put forth a recommendation to the board at RCP, and they selected that as one of the plays they would do for this year.
Okay. I'll go into a group talking about the show itself. If you folks are familiar with some of the origins of it, I'm sure the people at home would enjoy hearing a little bit about that. But Mary, first of all, let's find out about your role in the show.
So Molly is the new owner of Monkswell Manor, along with her husband, Giles. And we are getting ready, expecting our guests, and things happen.
As they usually do in history.
I'm not sure what I can say.
It occurs on the evening of a blistery, wintry night in London, or in the London area. Mm-hmm. So the storm is setting in, and several of the guests are about to become trapped at Monkswell Manor. Mm-hmm. That's the best way of saying it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Brian, tell us a little bit about your role.
I play Giles Ralston, husband to Molly. And yes, we have taken on a mansion that was willed to my wife, and she decided that she wanted to make it into a guest house. And this is our first weekend with guests. And I don't know if it'll be our last, but, but it is very mystery-provoking, very mystical at times, the way I look at it, because every time you hear somebody speak, you're thinking about what is going on and who may be that person or persons out there that are doing things. And all Molly and I keep doing is trying to keep everything afloat and the house keep running. Mm-hmm. And we come into certain situations that sometimes we don't like, but we move on. Mm-hmm. Did I not say anything?
You did a great job.
Okay.
Very fine. Very fine.
Hold on.
I play Miss Casewell. I'm one of the last guests to arrive, not the last guest to arrive, but one of the last guests to arrive. I am from out of country, and I chose this guest house because I was looking for a quiet place to stay in the country. And I'm there to see to some business that I must attend to before I go back to where I came from.
Very good. Can you tell they've been well coached about not giving any clues away?
Yeah, we can't mention that Julius Caesar's bludgeoned Brutus to death with bad jokes in the Colosseum while playing cards
right.
with a lion. So did I give it away?
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool.
No, that's it. We're done.
Misdirection.
Yes.
I was going to say it's the interesting thing. This has been running since 1952.
Yes.
And people have been keeping a secret.
Since 1952, it started life in 1947, I believe, as a radio show, and was a birthday gift to the Queen at the time. And it's been running ever since, except for COVID. COVID did put an end to continuous runs, unfortunately, but they are back up and running, and it'll probably run for another who knows how long. But it's a very, very popular play, and I think the fact that it is so secretive keeps people coming back. The other thing I like about it, and we've worked very hard with the cast, is to understand what Agatha was writing and possibly why she was running it. Mm-hmm. As you know, David, there's every play, every book that's out there has a lot of underlying tones, a lot of underlying meaning, and the actors picking up on those pieces of the underlying reasons for what's going on has been key to what we've put together for this show. Because there are a lot of underlying things going on. A lot of aha moments, even for the cast. We're still finding them. We found one last night, an aha moment.
Good. Because that's one thing about Agatha Christie that I've always admired. She had a way of writing plays and in such a manner that each successive director and cast put something into it that, I didn't realize that was there. And all, and
that is definitely us.
So, and it's a very good character study.
It is, yes.
Of people, their motives and motivations, and what they do or do not do, and all. So, I'd like to find out from you folks, Mary. I'll start with you about your character, and tell us a little bit about the character itself. Who is she? What motivates her? What are the things that you've done to kind of get an idea about who she is so that you can do a wonderful job showing
her? Okay.
He's looking at me like, I got this. Molly's a caregiver.
Okay.
And I think that's all she wants to be. She she takes in the strong, she takes in the weak. She just wants everything to be well and good and in its place, and the love reflecting. And she just wants to take care of people. And when things go wrong here and there, it's a little unnerving.
Does she have any interesting characteristics that you've either made, developed for your character, or that the script brought out? And again, I understand you're not going to give out clues as to whom it is, because it's a wonderful, wonderful turn of events at the end. What, in the middle? And even in the beginning?
Yep, even at the beginning. No, I can't help you there.
No, I know you can't. I just tried to look between the lines and really feel what she was feeling and think what she was thinking. And
she's in the moment.
She's very in the moment
of what's going on around her. And the fact that she's doing this for the first time, she is a business savvy person, and she, for the first time, has an opportunity to try her business sense. And see if she can make something of it. And I think that describes Molly to a T.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's interesting to find out. Okay, this is an interesting part about the character from a business viewpoint on that. So what she does, who she is directed a bit by that particular mindset because it's different from other people who may like to, as caregivers, might like to go out into the world and actually do something like a doctor or a social worker or something like that.
As a caregiver, she wants to bring people into her nest and then have some kind of control over it. And she wants to come across as, you know, the mother hen that has just is watching everything over it. But then there's some little thoughts that are in there.
Well put.
Okay. All right, Brian, tell us a little bit about your character. Get into his background and...
Without revealing anything. She left out bossy. She's bossy to her
husband.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
She's a controlling
person. But you do it
so well. Thank you.
Controlling.
Giles is a caring, considerate, hard-working individual. He comes from a nice family, upper-class family, but when he meets Molly, he just likes what he sees in Molly. And we married young, and we married quick. And she got the house, so we decided to do this together. So Giles, to me, is one of those, he'll do anything for his wife. So he, whenever she says something, he's going to do it. And he's a caring individual, too. So that's why he said, yeah, let's do this. We'll bring people into our house. But he's very defensive and very protective of his wife. And when things go astray, Giles gets a little unnervy at times. And he portrays that, but he holds back a little bit because, again, uncertainty's all there. But he's very, very protective.
Okay.
I can't say anymore.
No, that's good. You know, the more that I think a person in the audience understands what is motivating them, the more interest they get into the character and go, oh, so that's why he or she is doing this and that, and oh, they're doing whatever it is for whatever reason that is, and then you just find out and learn how and why these characters, and I find that very, very interesting. And, no matter how many times I've seen shows and all, Knowing the backgrounds of everyone is for me is very fascinating anyway.
Oh yeah, definitely. We can say that there's seven cast members because that's definitely
well, there's eight cast members.
Eight cast members. I wasn't Being very
you weren't. Well, you weren't
being very generous
yourself.
There.
You were being generous.
So yeah, and that's the one thing that when everybody's brought into our home, he starts to like, okay, where can I see Molly? I want to know where Molly is all the time, mm-hmm. and kind of tries to stay on the top, but never does.
I would say also that you had mentioned, and I'll follow up on it, that this is the kind of play that you can go back, see it one time, and you want to go back mm-hmm. the second time
yes.
to
yeah.
see all the things that you now know.
Mm-hmm.
And this is certainly one of those types of plays that mm-hmm. is brings that out in your mind. You want to go back and see if you can pick up all the clues that were put in.
To me, it kind of reminds me of a magician and all. Because if you've worked a magic show, you know, and you know how the magic is done, the illusions and all that, you know, well, many times you have to sign a very hefty waiver saying if you reveal these things, you yeah. will be fine. You will have to pay a lot of money.
We cannot tell you if there is misdirection mm-hmm. or prestige.
Right.
So anyway, I had the privilege of doing that, and I learned a number of different illusions and how they're done, and I never ceased to be amazed by the proficiency of the magician, mm-hmm. and that's in a way what you folks are being,
yes.
a magician, pretty, and especially in this case with the secretive ending and all that, you know, how it is resolved.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of know it, but you make a vow not to reveal. So it's always fresh.
Yes.
Renata, tell us a little bit about your character and where she's coming from.
Oh, okay. Miss Casewell can seem a bit aloof. She's there to take care of some business, and she's kind of single-mindedly looking in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's times where she lets her hair down, so to speak. Mm. Parts of her situation come out. It's almost like she wants to talk to people about a certain mm-hmm. situation. Then she pulls back again because I believe she's developed some defense mechanisms
mm-hmm.
To protect her from some things
mm-hmm.
and trying to tiptoe around here. And I think she struggles with that mm-hmm. through the entirety of the play, yeah. wanting to be forthcoming, but then withdrawing, mm-hmm. and
she's put up a shield.
Yes.
She has a shield, and then she stays behind that shield, mm-hmm. and then on occasionally that shield starts to slip.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say it sounds like she does not try to let a moment go by, an unguarded moment go
mm-hmm.
by, so that she
yes.
maintains who her identity and who and what she is.
Mm-hmm. Well put.
Okay, tell us a little bit about some of these other characters in the show, and maybe how, and the cast, maybe how you might relate to them or react to them. Again.
Well, we can identify the characters.
A little bit that, about that, you know.
We have, of course, Miles and, yeah, I did that all the time, Giles and Molly. We have Miss Casewell. We have Mrs. Boyle. We have Mr. Wren. And we have Major Metcalf. And then, of course, we have the detective that comes in to try to figure out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
That rounds out the entire cast.
And Paravicini.
Oh, and I forgot Paravicini. Thank you. Paravicini, mm-hmm. yes. Mm-hmm. Another surprise.
That's what I was thinking.
That's why you were leaving it out. That's why you said only seven.
That's
gotcha.
Why I only said seven.
And watch for the cameo by the lamp.
Yes.
Oh,
it's a joke.
It's a joke we have going on about a particular lamp on the set. It was upstaging everybody.
And we had to fire the chair.
Yeah. It's just some of the backstory that goes on when you're trying to put a play together.
Yeah. You didn't happen to take the lamp from Christmas Story.
No, no, it was not that lamp.
No.
That would steal that, especially this one.
Yeah.
Who are the rest of the cast?
Sean Hafer is playing Wren. Patrick
O'Neill
is playing Sergeant Trotter. Brian Cook is playing Major Metcalf. Deb Brubaker is playing Mrs. Boyle, and Laura Stewart is playing Paravicini. Did I get them all?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. Yeah. Those of you who may know them will be interested in watching how they develop their characters and how they relate in there. Again, this kind of reminds me of one of the shows that you folks did recently, An Inspector Call.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Where, you know, everyone comes in and they have their own secrets, their own part in that, and then the inspector comes in and gives them some insights mm-hmm. into themselves. And I find that fascinating with shows like
yes.
this. Has it?
I do as well, and I think I tend to gravitate as an actor toward comedic roles, mm-hmm. and as a director toward the dramas.
I was going to say exactly the
were
same
you gonna
thing.
Say
yes, I was.
But that seems the way it is, and I love delving into all the nooks and crannies of it. Mm-hmm. I was not a very good English student when I was in high school. Mm-hmm. Could have cared less about it, but now that I'm older, I have a better opinion of books mm-hmm. and how the author can weave a story in there and all the underlying things that are going on. Mm-hmm. And the cast will tell you that we worked very diligently to try to get them to understand, and ourselves as directors, being co-directed by Nicole Genist, and we worked very diligently to try to bring that out as to what was the meaning of this. Why did she write this particular thing in this particular way at this particular time in the story? So
with specific punctuation.
With specific punctuation marks, yes. Mm-hmm. Exclamation points, question marks. And so there's a meaning, and you can change the entire meaning of a line if you miss those punctuations mm-hmm. or if you interpret those punctuations incorrectly. Mm-hmm. And that can change the entire outcome. So finding all those nuances is mm-hmm. something I love to do with dramas, and in particular mm-hmm. stories like An Inspector Calls and like The Mousetrap. We almost every night we would have an aha moment that we would figure out mm-hmm. that's what this meaning, that's why this is here, that's what it means, this is why things are going the way direction they have to go. And I'm hoping that that comes across when we do our presentation of it. I honestly believe that the actors will get that story out. They've done a great job bringing it forward.
It's amazing how a very simple word, and depending on how you say it, can change its meaning entirely.
Absolutely,
yes.
Absolutely.
Even the pause between certain words.
Yes.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. What is said or not said can be just as revealing. You know, I remember working on a show a long, long time ago where I was a stagehand, and we had to move things, and if an actor got in the way or anything, or if we need people to get through, we would say, please get out of the way. Mm-hmm. We always used, you know, courtesy and all that. But depending on who it was, what their reputation for it was, depending on how they got the please.
Yeah.
Right.
Please in such a way that, no. I don't think I want to be in the way. Yeah. So, anyway, how do you think your characters have grown into, you have grown into the characters, and the characters have grown into their interactions? Do you find yourself being comfortable with your interpretations of it so far, and guiding along that? Because some of those, you know, are on the surface kind of stock type of people. But their motivations on that and how they react to others can be interesting.
When I first started with Miss Casewell and developing the character. I didn't see the humor originally that was written into her character. Mm-hmm. She does have some moments where her sense of humor comes out. There were certain areas that were a little more obvious, but then there were some other areas that, as I read the script more, as I performed it more, interacted more, I was like, this is actually a funny moment. And not, you know, you don't want to try and push it, but there's just some instances where I found out that as aloof as she seems, she's got a sense of humor too. She's got a quirky side too.
She does.
I might be able to relate to that. Anyone who knows my anyway.
Every great story has comedy in it. Mm-hmm. There's comedy in dramas, and you can find it wherever you look. So.
Yeah. I remember one line that Groucho Marx had mentioned about the. It was a joke. He goes about a guy being. On the gallows about to be executed, and he's asked for a last word, and he goes, you know, I don't think this darn thing is safe. And, you know, you find the craziness in that and in the moment. How about you two? Have you found anything that, especially since you're dealing with all these different personalities, I guess, and all that sort of thing?
Well, Giles has some hidden little things about him which I didn't see in the beginning when we're just reading and going on the lines, and it's kind of interesting what he does not like, and he makes it known too, and he has some little comedic lines as well, or does some little things too that will bring out some maybe a snicker or a laugh here or there, but it's interesting how I don't want to use the word staunch, but he's certainly a character of feeling, but he has these little things that in today's world would not be accepted, but back then he brings them out very freely. That was interesting, because I didn't pick it up right away, and it was like, oh, that's what they want. And it seems to be working, because under Randy and Nicole, they're saying, I'm hearing the claps, or that, or, but Giles is definitely has a hidden personality kind of thing.
And for as strong as their relationship is, I think they're still discovering things. I mean, they've been married a year, they feel very strongly about each other and that they know each other, but there's still little things. You know, whether it's 1 year or 20 years that you discover about someone.
Right.
Mimics true life.
Yeah, it's amazing how people, as they go along life and all, find out things that they didn't really realize about each other or themselves. And this is one of those shows that I think is good for that self-discovery. Speaking of self-discovery, why don't we take a moment and discover a little bit about the show itself. Brian and Mary, I believe you have a scene that you prepared.
Shall we introduce them to Monksville Manor?
Ooh, let's do it.
And you may go off, take off your lavaliers, and if you will go out in front. All these... wonderful things. Now, you folks at home are going to be not only seeing this and all, but there are so many different productions being done in the area, so I hope you get out to see all the other ones. I hope to be able to have some time to bring up some of the that information later on. So, if you'll go and set up, Randy, if you'll set up.
Absolutely, I can set this up. This is actually pretty close to the top of the show. And Giles and Molly are getting back to the inn just after their day and just before the guests arrive.
Oh, okay. Doesn't matter. Molly, where are you?
Doing all the work, you brute.
Oh, there you are. Now leave it all to me. Shall I stoke the aga?
Done.
Oh, hello, darling. Your nose is cold.
Oh, just come in.
Why? Where have you been? Surely you've not been out in this weather.
I have have to go down to the village to get some stuff that I'd forgotten. Did you get the chicken netting?
No, it wasn't the right kind. I went to another dump, and that wasn't any good either. Practically the whole day wasted. And my God, I'm nearly half frozen. The car was skidding like anything, and the snow's coming down deep. I'm sure it will be snowed up tomorrow.
Oh, I hope not. If only the pipes don't freeze.
We'll have to keep the central heating while stoked. Not too good. I wish they'd send a Coke along. We've not got any too much.
Oh, I do want everything to go so well at first. First impressions are so important.
So, everything ready? No one's arrived yet, I suppose.
No, thank goodness. I think everything's in order. Mrs. Barlow's hooked it early. Afraid of the weather, I suppose.
What a nuisance these daily women are. That leaves everything on your shoulders.
And yours. This is a partnership.
Just as long as you don't ask me to cook.
No, that is my department. Anyway, we've got plenty of tins in case we are snowed up. Giles, do you think he'll be all right?
Oh, got cold feet, have you? You're not sorry now that we didn't sell this place when your aunt left it to you instead of running it like a guest house?
No, I'm not. I love it. Talking of guest house, look at that.
Well, pretty good, isn't it? What?
Well, it's a disaster. You've left out the S. Monkwell instead of Monkswell.
Oh. God, so I have. However did I come to do that? Oh, but it doesn't really matter, does it? Monkwell is just as good a name.
Oh, you're in disgrace. Go stoke up the central heating.
What? Cross that icy yard? Oh, shall I bank it up for the night now?
No, you don't do that until 10 or 11 o'clock at night.
Oh, how appalling.
Hurry, someone will be here at any moment.
So you've got all the rooms worked out?
Yes. Mrs. Boyle, front four-poster room. Major Metcalf, book room. Major Metcalf, blue room. Ooh. Miss Casewell, east room. And Mr. Wren, oak room.
Ooh, I wonder what all these people will be like. Oughtn't we to have gotten rent in advance?
Oh, I don't think so.
Oh, we're rather mugs at this game, you know.
They bring luggage. If they don't pay us, we keep their luggage. It's quite simple.
I can't help thinking we ought to have taken a correspondence course in hotel keeping. We're bound to get had in some way. Why, their luggage might just be bricks wrapped up in newspaper, and where should we be then?
They all wrote from very good addresses.
Well, that's what servants with forged references do. Why, some of these people might be criminals hiding from the police.
I don't care what they are, so long as they pay us 7 guineas each week.
Oh, you're such a wonderful woman of business, Molly.
Very good, thank you. Thank you, as a lawyer's back on. We'll find out. There's something about this show that I think I have read. It inspired some of the playwrights down the line.
You probably got more details than I do.
Okay.
I was more interested in trying to figure out where mm-hmm. she was in history and what was going on in history. Mm-hmm. I do know that the radio show was called Three Blind Mice.
Okay.
Her basis for her story was actually the death of a young boy that occurred in mm-hmm. England at the time. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much where I had ended that. I know mm-hmm. that... the fact that she had the longest running show, Noel Coward sent her an offhanded thank you or congratulations mm-hmm. in regard to it. But that's pretty much where I ended it. So if it inspired mm-hmm. other shows or other plays to mm-hmm. come into existence, that would be something I really didn't mm-hmm. study. So.
Okay, because I just took a quick glance at some of the information that had come along with the general discussion, description of
sure.
the show, and I found that out. I also found that it was very, first of all, about inspiring people. Tom Stoppard, one of our more modern playwrights, had learned a lot from her and her style of writing mm-hmm. and the mysteries that most people really enjoy because of a certain way of knowing when to reveal things, when to hide things, and how to turn things around, mm-hmm. and maybe lead you down a path, and then, whoops, no, maybe there's another thing to that. Did you find a lot of that type of thing as you were going through your scripts and mm-hmm. all that, and picked up some tips or whatever for either acting or for, well, you directing or anything like that?
Certainly from the perspective of what the outline of the play is, it does follow a common standard. The characters are introduced, the setting's introduced, mm-hmm. the timeline's introduced. Then we have some kind of conflict that occurs. Mm-hmm. You have some kind of death that occurs. Mm-hmm. And then you go into figuring out all the clues. Oh, I forgot that some person, a detective or a Poirot type comes into the scene, mm-hmm. or Miss Marple comes into the scene and goes through all the clues to try to come to a finish at the end and solve solve the case. Mm-hmm. And certainly this follows the same pattern as a lot of those do. Mm-hmm. The nuances of this are in the characters themselves, mm-hmm. and what's going on inter-character. Mm-hmm. One character to another character, or one character to two other characters, and how they all mm-hmm. interact. And that's I think that's probably the meat of the show. Like I said, the setup is the first scene, the conflict start to exist in the second scene, and then we finish Act 1 with intermission. We go to Act 2, where we figure out all the clues, and all the clues are coming out, and to the conclusion of the play at the end of the act.
It's, and hopefully I'm allowed to say this, and I've directed a lot of Sherlock Holmes. I'm a big Sherlock Holmes mm-hmm. fan, and I always look at these mysteries, mm-hmm. Whether there's murder involved or whatever the mystery mm-hmm. it is, there's always a lot of finger pointing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you get that in a lot of mystery. And mm-hmm. you're gonna probably see that a little bit in this one too, mm-hmm. where someone wants to take it off their shoulder and put it on someone else's shoulder mm-hmm. and put it on their shoulder and whatever. I mean, mm-hmm. it's that kind of play in action that you were talking about a little earlier. Mm-hmm. I always call it finger pointing.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it.
Yeah.
Because eventually the finger comes back around to you.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Shifting that blame.
Shift, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I love it because for all the clues that she puts, it's like a giant grid or Venn diagram, because there's all these little bits that could be anyone.
And how maybe one character might influence another character to do or not do.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The intended thing, you know, and the reaction to it and all. Is there a change? Is there something that may happen that, oh, I was going to do this, but I guess I won't mm-hmm. because of whatever?
All good questions to be answered by coming to see the show.
Good. Yeah. Well, that's a part of the fascination of theater and all. Yes, go out and have a good time, be entertained, and hum a song from the show you just saw, or think of a funny line that makes you smile, mm-hmm. and you can carry that with you. Maybe think of find something that inspires you for this, that, or the other thing. Has that happened to any of you at this point in time by going through the characters and the situation? Have you found anything in there that has had some kind of meaning for you, an insight, a spark?
There's some issues with my character that very much mirror situations that I had in my youth. Mm-hmm. So even to down to the name of mm-hmm. the character. Mm-hmm. So it was almost a little spooky to me at first when I got into this character. Mm-hmm. But I can't say anything more, but
mm-hmm. Sure. I remember some of the shows or scenes I did for either class or for a production I was in. And there are little snippets from there that, you know, come out from time to time. Oh, yeah, this happened and it might make me laugh. Especially that can be useful if you're not feeling up to par that day or whatever, or give you pause thing, oh, maybe I should consider this before I do that.
I don't know, and I've heard it already with other casts, is that when you do a play, mm-hmm. of course, it's ingrained in your head for some time, even after the show is done, mm-hmm. and you're still using some of those lines from your play in your daily life. Mm-hmm. It's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one example from mine is Peter Schaefer's Public Eye. It was about an accident that happened. This guy was describing how he was chasing this suspect and all that, and he was following a car painted a discreet shade of daffodil.
Oh.
And when I heard that, I roared. We all roared on that. But every now and then, I see a car go by, and it's a bright yellow one. Yeah. I go, and I do that line either in my head or out loud. And really neat to remember those types of things. What do you have going on for you with this? This, again, is a two-weekend run, correct?
It's not, no.
No, one weekend?
One weekend.
So you folks have one chance to see it this weekend. No. So,
1 weekend, 3 chances.
1 weekend, 3 chances.
1 weekend,
all
three
right.
chances, yes.
Right. And what are the show times for this?
We have a show Friday night at 7:30, Saturday night at 7:30, and a Sunday matinee at 3 p.m. Right. And it has been receiving a great response on Facebook and our website. So we're very hopeful that additional people will see that and be willing to come out and see it. Again, we're opening up theater locally, everybody. Mm-hmm. Masks for this production are at your own discretion. We're not going to tell you you can't wear a mask. We're not going to tell you that you have to wear a mask. Mm-hmm. So please feel free to do however you feel is best for you. Mm-hmm. And bring the whole family out. There is certainly no reason why the entire family cannot see this show. Mm-hmm. It's entertainment. It's great entertainment. It's live theater with a wonderful venue, a beautiful set, I understand. Mm-hmm. And a fantastic cast.
The doors open a half an hour before each of the shows.
Okay.
So 7:00, 7:00, and then 2:30. And we ask that you enter from the main, which would be 6th Street, mm-hmm. The main portion of the church.
Mm-hmm. Now, are tickets available at the door as well as, are they available online as
tickets
well?
Tickets are online. You can purchase them online through TicketLeap. Just go to our website or Facebook page, and then they'll direct you to our website to order. Tickets are general admission as well, so you can purchase your ticket at the door. They're $18. We are definitely don't want to say inexpensive, but we want to keep it very inexpensively
reasonable?
Comparable, feasible to our audiences. Mm-hmm. We're going to give you a great show for a reasonable price.
Yeah, that is one thing about amateur theater, community theater, nonprofit organizations. They do rely, they do keep the cost down because in some cases they don't have a lot of overhead at a point in time. But they always need some contributions or help along the way to help keep those costs down for the tickets and all.
Especially when we don't have our own venue.
Yeah.
That makes it very difficult.
Yeah. And this isn't Reading Community Players' main venue anymore. You had one.
Well, we did have one at 11th and Buttonwood.
Right. Yeah.
That we owned that theater.
You owned that. Yeah.
And sold that 5 or 6 years ago now.
Mm-hmm.
So we are at the mercy of our local area to put on productions. And right now we have been using the Bear Chapel for shows. but mm-hmm. we use other venues as well if they're available, mm-hmm. The WCR. Mm-hmm. We've used the Abe Lincoln already in the past. Mm-hmm. We used a facility on Hampton Boulevard, I do believe it is. It's now become back to the Reading School District. So again, we've been mm-hmm. out there, but we are at the mercy of facilities. So mm-hmm. that's one thing that our goal is this year, is to reach out and see if we can find a home to call mm-hmm. our place, that we can mm-hmm. have a place that you know and associate with Reading Community Players.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I remember many a fine time in the 11th and Buttonwood location.
Oh, yeah.
As well as some of the other theater groups I've worked with in this area, and also, and you know, it does take a bit to keep it going. When you have your own place, you have utilities and this, that, and the other thing that you need to deal with, and also, this is kind of a way of saying, well, if you go to it. And enjoy it. Maybe you have a couple extra bucks that you could put in a donation jar to them.
We'd appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Quick word on parking. I know that the city has changed their parking requirements. And as it turns out, it's going to work out fairly well for us. There is a flat lot, which is across the church's main entrance mm-hmm. on 6th Street. The entrance is on Cherry. Mm-hmm. And on Friday night, because there's an event at the arena, the lot will charge you $5 at that location. Saturday night, the lot will be free after 6 p.m., and Sunday all day it's free there. So if you go into the garages in the city, some of those can be very expensive, but the mm-hmm. lot that's right there at the corner of this be the going towards...
The entrance is on 5th Street.
It's
along Cherry, between 5th and 6th. The entrance is from 5th and leads up to 6th.
Very good. Thank you.
Many times.
Yeah, if you're not familiar with downtown, that helps mm-hmm. to have an idea and how to get there and how parking is.
Yes.
Because, you know, with the event parking fees now, it can be a little bit hard for certain mm-hmm. groups to afford to be
yes.
to be there. So, what you contribute by just purchasing a ticket to go in there, or if you, as I said, if you've got a couple extra bucks that you can spare, you know, I know things are right now a little tight and tough, but if we all are working together, we'll get through this without too much trouble. So I presume, before I let you go, I wanted to ask, what are the upcoming plays for the rest of the year? Does anyone know at this point?
I hope. As the treasurer of the organization, yes, I do know. We have our next show after this, which will be Midnight Summer Dream. It's going to be a Shakespeare in the Park. Going to be in a facility somewhere, park facility in the Wernersville area, from what I understand. That's where the director lives, and she was mm-hmm. able to acquire mm-hmm. the park. It's going to be 2 days, I think a Friday night and a Saturday afternoon, if I remember right. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that's the first weekend in June. I don't have the dates on the top of my head. Mm-hmm. Then we have our junior production, Oliver. That's going to be performed right down the road here at the Miller Center.
Okay.
End of July. Again, I don't have dates on me. And the production after that is going to be called The Calendar Girls. And that is going to be held at where we're doing Mousetrap, mm-hmm. at the Bear Chapel. And that is in end of September, mm-hmm. first weekend in October. And then we have Plaza Suite. That's going to be, I'm directing or co-directing that with Nicole. And that's going to be the weekend of Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. I can tell you that. So we have this is the first time we've done this many productions with Reading Community Players in a long, long time. Mm-hmm. We're excited. We did have another one slated Unfortunately, that fell through because of calendar situations. Mm-hmm. So we do have 5 productions this year. So.
And what's the website that they can go to find out more about these?
The website
things?
For us is readingcomplayers.com. I can never remember that.
Readingcom, C-O-M-M, players.com.
Okay. Well, break a leg with the
show. Thank you.
And I want to go and do just a quick bringing of what's coming along. So if you need to go and all, you may take off your lavaliers and go. But I won't. I only have a few minutes left to do this, so I can do that. I want to mention that the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival and Act One up at DeSales University are doing some good productions coming up. This weekend as well, a dance ensemble concert up there. This weekend, and they have a film festival that that's coming up at the end of March, they just finished a production of Our Town. Let me see. They have a fascinating schedule for the summer. Every brilliant thing. It's very mature type of thing. It's not that kids can't see it, but it's a very serious premise to it. And I'll have more on that later on. A chorus line is being done, Much Ado About Nothing from Shakespeare. And August Wilson's Fences. Plus their children's show and other productions along the line there. I am just going to mention Genesius has their one more weekend with their production, Once Upon a Mattress, Junior, I think that's his. I've got that correct. You can go to their website and get tickets for that as well, as I believe at the door. Coming up a little bit later on in the semester at Albright College, the theater department will be doing The Intelligent Design of Jenny Chow, and Julia Matthews is directing that. And that's all the time I have for tonight. It's been a wonderful time with you and the folks from Reading Community Players, and until I see you next time, take care and stay safe.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.